Welcome back to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins and for Mike Papantonio this week. Global financial institutions recognize the threat of climate change and agree that it needs to be addressed. However, their actions contradict their talking points, and I've got Brendan DeMelle, managing editor of desmogblog.com, with me now to tell us why the rhetoric is nothing more than lip service. Brendan, you know, the World Bank has come out and they've said that climate change is a huge threat to global financial markets, threat to the environment, threat to economies. So what exactly is their role in climate policy?
Thanks for having me, Farron. It's an interesting situation here with the World Bank. It's sort of, it's got a new face. The new president is actually speaking very powerfully and eloquently about the climate threat. And one of his first actions was to put out a strong report pointing to the need for more climate spending and for moving away from fossil fuels and ending fossil fuel subsidies and moving towards clean energy. So those were all positive developments, and it's great that he's there. But that's on the coattails of a World Bank that's been extremely destructive in funding fossil fuel projects all over the world. In just the last 5 years, the World Bank's dumped over $20 billion into fossil fuel projects. So they've got a long way to go from a deep hole that they've dug by wetting the world's economy to coal and other fossil fuels. So their role now is to see if they can fix that, and it's going to be a tall order because they don't, you know, have autonomy. They take their orders from the United States, the European Union, and other world governments who, you know, it's a mixed bag whether or not those governments want to see action on climate change.
So you end up with the governments calling the shots, but we all know who's calling the shots on the government, and that's the people funding the campaigns. And unfortunately, at least for the United States and a few in the European Union, we do end up with the oil industry is a major funder, the coal industry, which they've already stepped up their attacks for the 2014 midterm hugely. So unfortunately, I guess if that's calling the shots for the World Bank, we know who's calling the shots for the government. But I do know that the World Bank has been involved in a couple issues in the past with, you know, investing in renewable energy. Have any of those gone anywhere?
Comparatively speaking, no. When you've got twice as much investment going to fossil fuel projects, they're showing their hand and where they're actually putting the priority. So, you know, there's, like I said, a long way to go before the clean energy investments start to make a dent in the fossil fuel infrastructure that they've built, which will last for decades, certainly. And they're still putting money into fossil fuel projects. So even though this new president has a commitment to stopping to fund all but the most extreme or coal plants in the most extreme cases when it's the only viable option, which in this hard to tell when that would be. But the fact is that the clean energy investments have nowhere near the resources or the political support. So it's going to take a huge, you know, game-changing move by all of the world governments. The bank can't do this by itself, even with a strong leader. We need strong leaders across the spectrum. And, of course, we had a lot of sabotage going on at the World Bank during the Bush years when Paul Wolfowitz was editing World Bank statements to take out climate change and downplay the risk of global warming. So, you know, they certainly have, as I said, a really long way to go. So it's anybody's guess. Time will tell.
Well, I think one of the issues, and you touched on it there, is the fact that we do have these investments in renewable energy. The Obama administration came out, you know, in their early years and put a lot of money towards renewable energy, but you end up with a media so willing to tell the story of something like a Solyndra, you know, they go under, we've essentially wasted that money, nobody wants renewable energy, but the truth is there's really no infrastructure in it. I mean, if you look at all these power grids that deliver, you know, electricity to homes, those are owned by the power companies. They don't want to share. They lose money in that case. And so there's a whole nother side to that story that really is not being told about the fact that people do want renewable energy. We want clean energy, but there is no delivery system right now. It's slowly coming together, but right now it doesn't exist. And I do want to switch gears for just a moment. I understand you recently went to the climate talks over in Poland, and there was a big to-do because I know the coal industry had a very large presence there. So explain what happened.
Yeah, I mean, it was certainly a far cry from the Copenhagen negotiations a few years ago, which were heavily, greened and greenwashed by the Danish government and others. This was, Poland made no attempt to greenwash itself. It actually went the opposite direction and held a concurrent coal summit, a clean coal summit, they called it, during these international climate negotiations. And they sort of thumbed their nose at the international community by not only having that coal conference, but funding, having corporate partners put on the event, including an oil company that supplied all of our drinking water, ironically, and other signs. You can see a giant coal plant from the stadium where we were assembled. So, the influence of dirty energy was everywhere, and Warsaw was done a disservice by that. There was very little movement towards progress, and again, we're looking at two full more years of endless negotiation until the world governments have to do something in Paris in 2015, the end of 2015. So it's a long road till then, but Warsaw was pretty much, a nothing burger.
Did you get any sense at all that maybe we were going to see any progress between now and 2015 with the next talks, or has it been so captured by industry that it's almost paralyzed?
It's paralyzed not just by, certainly by industry, and as you pointed out, governments that are beholden to industry. The new sort of ingredients now are that Australia, which used to be a sort of climate champion, is now gone completely 180, is led by a climate denier, and the Australian delegation was so rude and childish at the negotiations that they actually refused to negotiate, took off their suits, put on t-shirts, and ate snacks throughout the negotiations during one of the critical points in Warsaw. So we're seeing a lot more of bad actors. When we thought the U.S. and Canada had that role pretty well covered, we now have Australia and Japan and others that are meddling with the process. So like I said, it's going to be two more hard years of negotiations, but it's really hard to see action happening without a real, a shift in the conversation globally.
Brendan DeMelle, Managing Editor at desmogblog.com. Thank you for being with us today.
Thanks for having me, Farron.